final countdown.
Yeah. We are back with our final match of the evening. It's George Mason against UT Austin, split one apiece. Number 15 battling back against number 7. And it was one heck of a series indeed. Both teams, let me tell you, are good at playing to their team composition.
Oh yeah, Deegan, I hope you are hungry because we are having a three-piece dinner tonight. Now we saw...
Clip that one up.
Shen Bandaway, Maokai Bandaway, two top laners seen in the series already, and a Rise ban as well. So that was banned in the first game of the series by University of Texas Austin. They didn't ban it in the second game, and Rout certainly made them pay for it.
He did indeed. So Kha'Zix still getting through. Texas being tempted there. What do you do? What do you do if you're Texas here? So Graves taken off the board. Rek'Sai was left up. And Firefly is a heck of a Rek'Sai, and that's why that had continually been permabanned against him. So
Deegan, I'm convinced that Firefly plays bug champions.
Yeah, I agree. Elise,
the Kha'Zix, yeah, Rek'Sai isn't like a bug, but she kind of looks like a bug, you know?
It's a lose-lose for Vincent. And it's going to be Poppy picked up here. So the jungle pool going to be left up.
Yeah.
I guess Vincent feels comfortable with what is up. Elise is still up. Both what we said, the Kha'Zix and the Rek'Sai left up. So there are options there in the pool, and feeling like they need to go to a different top laner. Nautilus not cutting it.
Yeah, I don't really see any reason why you wouldn't pick Kha'Zix unless you're really planning for something. And also, 50 Shades of Kappa on the Poppy must simply be because they didn't really feel comfortable playing last game, since we haven't seen Poppy picked or banned so far in this series. So the... last game situation is certainly where you can pull out some interesting and cheesy, perhaps, compositions and champions. Speaking of the Rek'Sai, Firefly is going to lock it in. So, Deegan, you were correct in that prediction.
That's so cool because I'm usually never correct at those things. So, Rek'Sai locked in here for Firefly. And our boy Kondo going to get off the ash. He did well. He's upgrading to the Varus.
Well, yeah, you don't want to quit while you're behind. You want to quit while you're ahead. So we remember his great Ash play, and now he moves on to greater and greener fields.
Purpler fields, if we're talking Varus. Varus well, going to be true. Shooting those arrows and landing them up. But
yep.
Again, exciting win by George Mason, but let's not forget the exciting win that Texas had. Both teams methodical in their approach, got the early lead, and slowly choked out the opposing team. And both opposing teams attempted to find picks and find their way back in. They just didn't have enough damage. They didn't have the numbers advantage. They weren't able to rotate around the map.
Whoa.
Oh, it's an Ivern!
Wow. This is like the throwback off-meta EU-LCS pick. Because I don't really think any other region plays Ivern that often, if at all.
Not really. Vincent felt like the farming up with Warwick wasn't enough. Let's go ahead, pull out the Ivern, and get those camps as fast as you can.
The throwback off the EULC. This is interesting because Ivern is not an aggressive jungler.
No.
And not an early game jungler. Or not like... He doesn't have pressure, which is what the Graves gave Vincent in that first game.
Right.
And I'm wondering at this point, the Warwick was really farmed in the last game, but didn't really have that much of an impact on the game because Firefly just went off in Kha'Zix and there was no rebuttal. So I'm curious to see how they play this because running both Poppy and Ivern champions that we haven't seen so far, and that kind of play counter to the style where Texas found success in the first game is a little bit odd.
It's definitely a little bit odd, and it's also not one of his most played champions from this season. Lee Sin was up. He's very comfortable on Lee Sin. Yeah. Lee Sin fits the billing of the type of champion that he plays. So not going to be taken.
Holy
Another
moly.
Interesting pick coming in. It's going to be Kondo. I mean, it's going to be Ione on the Trundle in the top lane. So the aggression coming out there. And then Syndra getting locked in for Primeape.
Yeah, honestly, the way this pick and ban phase has gone down is like, if you would compare this to the other games without showing that the team names were the same, you would probably never guess that these were the same teams in a series, because these picks have been so different from the last few games, and without some of these key champions being banned away, Echo as well. So just a lot of swaps and a lot of like these pocket picks at the last moment from both sides. To talk a little bit about the Sivir pick that Railgun is running now, so he's not on the virus anymore. They're going to have Sivir and Karma to speed boost the team. And that's going to be really important because, again, their team, the engage on the team isn't super strong. There's a couple of skill shot based abilities that are crowd control, and it looks like the game plan for their engage is just going to be run at them super fast and make it nearly impossible for the enemy team to dodge your skill shots.
It's going to be very difficult, and I like it. These teams, again, distinct team compositions here. The team fighting, Ione trying to get all of the tanky stats that he can pick up from Poppy and then just sit on Railgun and on Perfect, hopefully trying to deter Primeape a little bit. Then on the opposite side, they want to run around, get a pick, use their numbers advantage to the best of their ability, does UT Austin. So Texas, again, pulling out a distinct team composition. I like it.
Now, given the early aggression we've seen really from both sides, I'm curious to see what like the jungle pathing is going to be, because the nice thing about Vincent on this Ivern, the way that he plays, obviously he doesn't kill the camps, he's their friend, he simply frees them of their shackles and then can roam around, whereas Firefly is going to be looking for those tunnel ganks as soon as possible, since he really doesn't need his ultimate. Rek'Sai doesn't need her level 6 movement ability to go for ganks early game. So couple that with the fact that both Trundle and Nami, those side lane champions, will have their own form of crowd control and the Echo to open up plays with the Rek'Sai. That kind of bodes well, especially against champions like Poppy or Syndra, who don't have any mobility to get away from early ganks. Especially considering Firefly was so impactful in that last game on Kaz. I would definitely look out for him and the impact he has in the early moments of the game, sort of as a sign to tell who will find a lead.
The last thing I wanted to touch on here is the fact that Alex and Perfect get to stay on their supports throughout the game. It's Karma and Nami. And we've got to see solid setups from both team members, right? Perfect has been able to get some solid snares down using the focused resolve and get team members in the right position using Defiance. And we've seen bubble after bubble and a couple of tidal waves being game-changing here from Alex. So both these supports have done their part to get their teams in position to victory. So with about a minute left, we'll get to see how well they do when we get into the game. But before we get into the game, let's thank our sponsors for making CSL possible, the Collegiate Star League possible, Band Gaming, the social app, the primary social app of the Collegiate Star League. Boards, calendar functions, polls, chat, and call functionality. Band is the premier social experience for you and your fellow gamers alike. Find out more at band.us/home. Twitch TV, the largest streaming platform in gaming to support us, college esports. Thank you so much, Twitch. From PAX East to PAX West, and many more events. I'll be there at PAX West. I'll see you guys at the Twitch party. PAX East. Esports wouldn't be what it is today without Twitch. Thank you so much. Follow them on Twitter and on Facebook, twitter.com/Twitch and facebook.com/Twitch. And finally, Asus Gaming, provider of everything esports, monitors, laptops, routers, graphics cards, motherboards, and more. Don't enter your next battle without Asus. So with that, we're going to go ahead and load into the game real quick. But when we come back, it'll be game 3 of the first Elite Eight matchup of the round or of the South bracket between George Mason University and University of Texas Austin. We'll be right back. It was indeed a short break, and we're back with George Mason against University of Texas in this best of three round of eight of the Southern Bracket. 1-1 is the score. Ooh. Texas taking an early lead, going 1-0, and George Mason going down.
Deegan.
And picking up the next win.
I don't want to cut you off, Deegan, but look at this. Could this be a potential invade?
Oh, no.
From GMU there, at least stacking that brush.
It could be a potential invade. It could be a counter invade.
Yeah, it could be defensive too.
The foe with the biggest club gets to be king. That's the rule.
That's the rules.
Oh, 50 Shades of Kappa.
That's what Trendle says. Those are the rules.
He's looking at it.
If he goes for this though, I don't know. There's. Oh, hold on. Wait. Oh, the timing of the vision is gonna be awkward.
Oh.
Yeah, that invade's definitely gonna work. Minions
have spawned. And that's it.
Oh, all right. That's a little bit anticlimactic.
It was. We all held our breath for a little bit, but now that we have it back, let's spend it on introducing our teams. On the blue side, it's University of Texas Austin, the Longhorns. In the top lane, it's 50 Shades of Kappa. In the jungle, it's Vincent. In the mid lane, it's Primeape. At AD carry and support, it's Railgun and Perfect, respectively.
And it's going to be Ion in the top lane for EMU, Firefly, Position, Route, Route, Rudy. And the mid lane, Kondo on the AD carry, and Alex. Once again, finishing the night off as that Nami support.
So, new bottom lane. Railgun is able to push in Kondo. Kondo's able to fight back a little bit, but expends a lot of mana. So we'll get to see how much mana he's forced to use to prevent the shove-in coming in from Perfect and Railgun. And Alex still kind of doing her thing, being a heal bot and finding CC as she can. I think one huge thing that George Mason did last game in game two to secure their victory was they had great vision control all over the map.
No, absolutely. We mentioned how successful the mechanical plays of both supports have been. They haven't really made any major mistakes, and both teams have had fantastic macro game. So shout outs to the supports for being an underrated role in the success of both teams to make it to the Elite Eight. But unfortunately, Deegan and the rest of you watching, only one team will actually make it to the Final Four. Now, which team is that going to be? That's what we're going to find out right now.
We're in the process of finding out. It's happening. It's happening, and you can't stop it.
Esports. Okay, I just want to point out the fact that it's literally 1 a.m. right now.
And it is.
GMU, again, it's midnight, I think, for Texas, right?
Oh, NA Cannon. Sorry, go ahead. That was the 1 a.m. showing.
Yeah, that's the 1 a.m. I think we might see some more 1 a.m., to be honest. It's draining. They probably have classes. I know at least one of these guys has to get up at 6. So, can you imagine playing this late and then coming back and just going to class? Oh, there comes Vincent.
Oh, here's Vincent, but Ion able to get himself out of trouble using the frozen domain to get the speed boost needed and will go down and help collapse.
Oof.
Oh, the scrying plant catching out Firefly, and Firefly's little invade won't be for too long. Probably he'll just pick up the scuttle crab there. Yep. So extended vision for the top side of the map, secured by George Mason.
Kondo chunked down Railgun for a decent bit of damage, but again, these champions are going to be running the longsword and potion route, or early item start, as opposed to the Doran's Blade, which we've seen really for years and years prior to Season 7. But because of the pokey nature of bottom lanes now, generally you will see AD carries go for the longsword, because it also builds nicely following items. So here comes a gank in the top lane.
Oh, nice pillar coming out. 50 Shades of Kappa in a little bit of trouble. Nice heroic charge into the wall and will get away. So flash burned, but a very, very slick move by 50 Shades of Kappa will get him out of trouble. Kappa Ross.
Yeah. That being said, though, that's
Kondo,
the early
please.
Pressure you want to see from the Rek'Sai. Also from the Echo. They got the flash. Poppy is going to have next to no escape the next time a gank might come onto the top lane. So that's That's really tricky for 50 Shades of Kappa to play around, and we have seen so much aggression from the junglers in the top lane throughout the series that I doubt that's the only gank we're going to see so far there before this game is done. For now, though, he does get out alive. See whether or not Ion is able to push his minion advantage a little bit farther as a result. But other than that, honestly, there hasn't been a giant discrepancy in any other lane other than jungle, I guess, but that's really not too much so far.
So Ion not able to back yet, and now being forced under tower, very dangerous position to be in because Vincent is there. And he's going to realize that's what's happening, uses Frozen Domain to get himself out of trouble, and will be backing and teleporting back in, but we'll be backing with a little bit more gold than what 50 Shades of Kappa was able to back with, so we'll have a little bit of a lane advantage once he teleports back in. Vision being traded again in the jungle, both red wards, control wards going down, and George Mason doing a solid job winning the Vision War.
Mm-hmm. Oh. 50 Shades of Kappa taking a little bit of damage.
Oh.
Level 6 is Trundle too. It almost looked like he might have gone for a fight there. Clearing out the ward here, potentially setting up a Rexxar gank, but a brilliant ward from the blue side means that the Rexxar was actually spotted in the Dragon Pit. Root trading nicely onto Primeape Syndra, but he's got his lost chapter. He has a couple of biscuits to chew on. He'll be just fine.
Both teams feeling each other out very early on. We're expecting to see a little bit more out of both. We're seeing the best out of both junglers. Firefly and Vincent were both the driving force behind each team's victory.
Mm-hmm.
And both underwhelmed in the opposing team's victory. So Firefly on his Prescient Rek'Sai, and Vincent pulling out an Ivor in that very, very dangerous, especially once you pick up Daisy, which he just has, level 6 now. But doesn't have a lot of game experience on him. So we'll get to see if, you know, the finer mechanics of Ivern slip by him or if he's able to work his way through it.
Yeah, because he's really a simple champion in the base, but when it comes down to it, he actually has some really complexities in how Daisy plays, the fact that you can have your teammates jump to the rooted target from his root collar. So Ivern is certainly, you know, one of the more recent champions in League of Legends and one of the more unique junglers we do see in the game. Ion had a strong trade onto 50 Shades of Kappa, so pushing him away for a little bit. And here comes the dive.
Oh, here does come the dive. Over a control ward is Firefly, but he gets taken away by the Keeper's Verdict. All the while, Ivern's on the way up. They've got to know it.
Yeah, they might not. I'm not sure whether or not he's not moving. Okay, Vincent is moving. Firefly knows.
Oh, and Firefly is going to go ahead and try to take it to him. He unburrowed, so he's not able to burrow right away. There we go. It does go under. Vincent's going to stand on top of it. Maybe.
Ooh.
Oh, and a long root collar brings Daisy into the fold. Ion might get popped up here. Will be able to walk himself out. Nice little play there by Vincent. That's going to take a lot of pressure off of 50 Shades of Kappa, and he's not going to get punished for not having flash up. Railgun now trading a little bit with Kondo, and ooh, the damage coming out of the piercing arrow. Now in the mid lane, Route going back and forth with Primeape, so little skirmishes all over the place, nothing too large yet. Vincent going to come and assert his dominance with Daisy. And there goes Daisy. Daisy's gone.
Yeah, so that little icon you saw on Ion was Daisy's auto attack stack, the third auto attack. It's a little bit of extra range and also knock up ability, so she gets empowered auto attack the more on an opponent. Another little interesting Ivern tidbit for those of you who may not know. Ooh, nice bubble action then after Railgun.
Railgun very lucky that there were minions still taking tower aggro.
That would have been a potential kill, and I'm surprised we haven't seen any so far deep, because by this point we had seen a couple traded the past two games, but like you said, it's the third game. They're feeling each other out. They want to play patient. No one wants to throw this or make the first mistake in the final match.
Oh, and Ione doing a number on 50 Shades of Kappa. 50 Shades of Kappa walking forward, and Ione just staying away from any walls that his heroic charge could stun him up against, and wins these trades up top. And that was the other key to victory, I believe, last game to George Mason. Ione showing up in the top lane and not getting bodied early on and eventually losing lane.
Yeah, the junglers feeding kills off of the top lane is how both games sort of got out of control, because both Vincent and Firefly had very impressive performance. So far, neither top laner faltering too much. Some CS advantages across the board. Sivir with a 25 minion advantage, kind of to be expected in that lane for sure. So nothing very surprising, and Ivern falling behind compared to the Rek'Sai. Also to be expected, as Rek'Sai is going to have so much clear with the team at. And now this trade isn't something that 50 Shades of Kappa can contain. And the thing is, Trundle into Poppy, Trundle is going to become a split-pushing nightmare, and I don't actually know if there's anyone to deal with it. Ouch, that's a lot of damage onto Ion, though.
It is a lot of damage. Ion messing that one up, flashes away. 50 Shades of Kappa has his flash, but the subjugate goes down. 50 Shades of Kappa doesn't want to use his flash, and he's baiting that one out back and forth. Now in the mid lane, both junglers are there. Route forced to use his ultimate and get out, and will be able to live. So Chrono Break saving the life of Route there, and you can see what counter-ganking ability Vincent has on the Ivern.
And still no kill. And the top lane, both champions going to sub 10% HP. In the mid lane, both mid lane champions forced to flash away and use their ultimates, neither going down.
Teleport coming in by Trundle right now, but it's not going to land too much. Now Poppy's coming in for the teleport, thinking about it, does complete it. Could have saved it to have that minute advantage, decides against it. And now it does look like both teams are focusing themselves on the bottom side of the map. Nope, they're gonna go back and start farming again in the jungle. 50 Shades of Kappa getting cut off. I'm gonna have to take a long way around. Ivern going to his blue buff to secure that and share it with Syndra.
Yeah, the question is Rek'Sai gonna let him? But there's actually not much he can do. Unless he really wants to fight Primate. Can he kill Primate from here? He might be able to, but here comes Echo as well.
Firefly able to get the knock up onto Primate. Not able to get enough damage down.
Yeah.
And Primate just able to walk away from that one.
That was a little overzealous. That being said, though, you know, why not go for it? It's not like it put him in a risky position, so. Bottom lane turret has taken a bit of a beating so far at 50% HP. Remember that early turret gold you get from killing the first turret is actually a pretty significant bonus. So good stuff so far to UT Austin bottom lane to find that advantage.
Oh.
Yeah, you and I were both thinking, is it gonna be? Because you'll see the answer to ultimate from Echo's Chrono Break instantly. But those stuns definitely are dicey. If he can get a stun on a low enough target, he could probably just instantly pop him down.
Possibly. 50 Shades of Kappa getting the win on these trades now. Got the chain vest down, and Ione now getting stunned up. We know that he doesn't have flash, and 50 Shades of Kappa does. This might be a 1v1. Subjugate forced to be used here by Ione. 50 Shades of Kappa gonna take that as a victory, or maybe not.
I don't think at this point in the game, in the third series, or excuse me, the third game of the series, 14 minutes into lane phase, we'll see either top laner break. They've been testing each other's limits pretty well. That being said, though, with Mylek Deagon, in the next minute or so, there's going to be another fight when one of them actually down. But so far, I mean, they're literally basically bang even in terms of farm. It's been a close fight in the top lane, and perhaps Vincent is going to try and push it in his laner's favor as he is jumping up there. Ooh.
Route going in on a Primate, gets stunned up and takes a tower shot, but gets a very nice trade in the mid lane. Rek'Sai thinking about a dive there, but all the while in the top lane, Ion doesn't have teleport, and it does look like this first tower will be getting chunked down pretty hard, if not all the way down.
Yeah, so it's not going to be the bottom lane red turret, but actually the top lane red turret that goes in just a moment, and there you go, 370 bonus gold, 375 for both champions, so nice little bit of gold in their pocket, essentially equal to a kill, and now a 1,000 gold lead to UT Austin, but still, 15 minutes in, zero kills.
Oh, recall stopped by Ione. doesn't mean too much. The mid lane tower goes down in response, so again, look at the gold. It's bang even. And just pressure has been opened up by George Mason.
It's going to be even, but on different sides. The Rek'Sai is going to have so much gold to deal with. She's also going to be doing quite a bit of damage with the Tiamat, as well as just the damage Rek'Sai does have. And ooh, this is interesting. Unwarded bush means an easy gank.
Does mean an easy gank. Railgun using spell shield, able to get away, flashes away, Firefly. Does not have flash. Oh no, Kondo going back to game one. Kondo missing the corrupting change, and here comes the counter engage. Primeape, there's the ultimate. Alex goes down, sushi time. Here's the flash forward heroic charge. Firefly getting awkwardly stunned up there, but a nice ultimate. Chrono Break burns this one, breaks it wide open. It's two for two so far. Route trying to slow down Railgun. Will, it's a triple kill heading on over to the Echo. All four members of University of Texas sat on top of Echo's Chrono Break and took tons of damage.
And turnaround after turnaround, that fight started from a counter engage, the counter gank from UT Austin. However, the outplay from Firefly flashing in and getting a huge throw, Route able to follow up with so much damage. And then we saw Ion using his TP to solidify the retreat. Oh my goodness, that was massive. Echo is going to have so much gold to deal with now. He already had that Hextech GLP and was hurting, or excuse me, the Protobelt was hurting for quite a bit. So after that turret being taken as well, they're currently pinging the dragon. They could probably just take it because there's not enough to contest. And yeah, that's a pretty big swing in GMU's favor, especially after it seemed like UT Austin was able to fight it.
Oh, I was thinking about it, not going to get it. And it's going to be a big swing. It did look good for UT Austin on the counter engage, but George Mason, Route with a huge play, turns this one back around, and the gold basically even, but here comes a little bit of pressure back from University of Texas. They're gonna be sieging down this mid lane, and it does look like George Mason isn't in a position to go ahead and contest.
No, they can't.
AD carry recalled.
Route's also sitting on about 2,700 gold, so he has a lot of kills, Egon, but he currently doesn't have that itemized, which means his wave clear is gonna be pretty poor. Well, Virus has made it back, but I think they're going to try and finish this siege.
Oh, Railgun getting caught up. It's a great pillar. 50 Shades of Kappa with a heroic charge. Route's able to go backwards. Ion still sitting there. Force the flash backwards. The subjugate not enough. And with that short skirmish, it's going to be the tower going down for University of Texas. Ion going back in and gets slaughtered. What are you doing?
Real poor disrespect there from GMU. Route sitting on so much gold, they still decide to fight. Kondo completely whiffed his ultimate, and then Ion just walking forward where he shouldn't have. Now the members of UT Austin, they're low to an extent, but it's still a 4v5. They might take this down.
Take this one down indeed. I think the wave clear is enough.
Yeah,
still needs to go back and buy.
Look at this rotation in the top lane, though. Two waves stacked up. Route still hasn't bought, like you said. Alex and Kondo, I mean, they're okay in terms of HP, but their mana is about half.
Route goes in. Does have Chrono Break, but isn't able to use it. Goes down immediately. Primeape still alive! No, there it is, Firefly. Able to go ahead and pick up his prey, the Prey Seeker. Taking that one down, perfect, very low, going to use Defiance. Ion looking for a pillar, not going to be able to get it. Kondo not going to have an effect in that fight either. But the shutdown comes out on Echo in the top lane.
And what an overstay by the members of the UT Austin. What? They just found a turret and a couple of kills. And like, it's the exact same mistake we saw GMU do 30 seconds prior. So, interestingly enough, both of these teams, after about 15 minutes of parity, are mirrored with the mistakes they're making as well. But finally, Route got to buy with 3,500 gold as he went down. Just completely buys a Lich Bane. And also, something you and I didn't actually point out is the Dark Seal has gotten a few stacks. He didn't opt to build it into a Medjay's, playing the conservative route. But that is the sign of an Echo who wants to go ham and wants to go off. And if he gets more stacks, that's really going to start adding up and spelling trouble for the Longhorns.
Just taking in the ambiance of a 6,000 gold lead for 600 gold lead for University of Texas.
That'd be more like a, that'd be less ambiance-ish, heavy metal-ish if there's a 6,000 gold lead at this point in the game. Still friendly and fun, close and even.
Oh, 50 Shades of Kappa wants it. Not gonna get it. Not gonna pick up the blue buff for himself. Mid laners with the blue buff. So Mason winning the vision battle on the top side of the map. Echo now going to start split pushing, does have teleport. That's a big advantage they're going to try to utilize. Kondo in a little bit of trouble, gets knocked up. Still up. A great bubble there by Alex into a two-man knockup with the tidal wave. Alex single-handedly giving her team an opportunity because here comes Rout. Rout picks up a kill onto the support. Perfect. Great, great play from the support. Nami coming out of Alex.
Kondo sort of acting as bait, but it was actually 50 Shades of Kappa who is in trouble, and then perfect was the collateral damage. And what fantastic tidal wave from Alex there to stop all aggression as GMU walk away with that kill. Now they are in the enemy jungle. Oh, Vincent doesn't know that they're there.
Vincent runs out. Oh, Kondo barely.
Yeah, that's
doesn't get root called, and that could have been a long struggle engage on the opposite side of the map. Ione able to take the top lane turret, and George Mason now settling in nice and comfortably to their split push composition. Ione in the top lane, Rout in the bottom lane. Teleport down, so maybe Rout will be able to just group up with his team and do a 4-1. They have a very solid team composition here for the team fights, as long as they don't engage too long. It's up to 50 Shades of Kappa to lead to a prolonged engage for UT and give Primeape and Railgun opportunities to dish out the damage.
Yeah, the engage style they have is a little bit peculiar compared to VMU. Flash away from Firefly. Oh boy, that's done. Yep.
Firefly, but now Kondo in a little bit of trouble. Perfect going to be going down here in a second to Rout. Rout on the killing spree. Kondo barely able to get away. Very, very lucky. The jungle is a dangerous place.
Rout.
Rout going over the wall, not going to be able to get the stun down. Will be able to take down poor old Daisy. But the parallel convergence not going to land on any stuns. And now the vision game going to be won again by George Mason. Look at all these wards now on the bottom side of the map after the initial engage.
Yeah. And there's a 6-1-1 Echo with 9 stacks. Has the CS total as well. That's quite a bit of tools for the GMU toolbox, and they are using it perfectly. Another Drake secured. That Mountain Drake gonna make sieging up against turrets as well as potentially taking down Baron much, much simpler. And Varus has percentage HP damage, so their Baron isn't incredibly fast, but it's not a slow Baron take either if they ever do decide to go for it. You know, it looks like the members of the Austin to rebuttal the enemy aggression pushed up into the mid lane, but then it does seem as if pull back a little bit and just get some wards around the Baron. Now, without any significant objectives other than the Baron up, all outer turrets remaining Deagon. It might be a few minutes before we get into the next team fight because based off of the vision that both teams have had, it's been pretty excellent. And I doubt that we're actually going to see an obvious pick unless one team completely outplays the other with a vision denial.
Well, I think that's it's not about a pick. I think it might be a fight over vision. They might just be like, okay, we're going to stand our ground over this ward and we're not going to let you bully us. And we know that you're doing a split here. So we're going to try to take our chances and burn you down before the teleport comes in. You know, it might be one of those kind of things. I think you're right, though. I don't think it's going to be just an empty pick here. Baron's on the board, but that's really about it. The top wave, and there it is. You can see the Rek'Sai now rotating over and will be shoving over that top wave. And has Void Rush to get himself out, so Firefly playing his champion to the fullest. Talking about Firefly, 156 CS to 101 of Ivern, and you know, that's okay if Ivern falls behind, but you have to be able to make an impact with your Root Caller and with Daisy, and he's not been able to do that.
Yeah, you have to give credit to the 100% kill participation that Firefly has found in the other games in the series as well, or at least, I should say, in the last game where he was impactful, he was up there in terms of percentage. I think his kill participation, excuse me, was around 75% by the end of the game, and currently he's sitting at 100, so they have the double split push pressure with the Titanic Hydra completed and the Tiamat as well. Ooh, teleport from Pod and Bentley and looking for...
Yep, so here goes the play and won't find it. And that's going to be absolutely catastrophic for Texas, because now Ione can split push and they will have no answer for it. Will Texas, a lot of pings going down on the mid lane. It does look like they want to engage onto a fight. Route going to step on top of 50 Shades of Kappa. It's a great pillar. Now 50 Shades of Kappa and 100... Oh gosh, 100 degrees of hurt, but it's going to be an ultimate coming down onto Alex. Alex getting taken out first, and a very, very nice ultimate is able to go ahead and knock away Route and Firefly. Kappa able to get away, but here comes Route. Ione in the fight as well. Route does get stunned up, forced to use Chrono Break, doesn't land too much damage on it. Kondo dealing auto attacks untouched, so is Railgun. Firefly not able to do what he wanted to do, getting into the back line. I am able to get Daisy. It's a two-man stun coming out of Primeape, but Rout takes him down, and it's one kill the mid laner trade out. Flash away, we'll keep him alive for a little bit longer. Down he goes. It's a kill traded for a kill. Mid laner's down.
I'm surprised that GMU actually felt ballsy enough to fight that while they were down a champion, but overall ends up being a trade, and now 50 Shades of Kappa has been walking back from the mid lane this entire time as he didn't go down to the gank, and they are going to be able to take this turret, Deagon, and potentially fight afterwards.
Void rushing from behind. They couldn't get the turret. 50 Shades of Kappa trying to do it, but Kondo's able to go ahead and barely land an arrow. There it is. Kondo finally picks up his first kill of the game. Welcome to the game, son. It's his first participation, and now it looks like the sights are on to Baron.
Oh my goodness. He just barely couldn't take the turret fast enough. I almost wonder if that would stakes by members of UTOS not actually hitting the turret when they should have. Because of that mistake, however, though, they're going to the Baron because there's nothing they can do.
Oh, Rout is able to go ahead and blow up perfect very early. The Baron will be secured here by George Mason. I had to go ahead and look around to see if there's any steal attempts.
Oh, boy.
Primeape wants to see if he can get any late recallers. Kondo!
All right, you're dead.
Oh, down he goes. Flash over the wall! No, Kondo! Bad, Kondo, bad! Be game two, Kondo. Don't be game one, Kondo. Down he goes. Baron removed from him, and Primeape...
Oh, boy. To Kondo's credit, he is playing ADC in 2017, but on the other hand, he's had some pretty big blunders. Oh, he's been unfortunate enough to... or we've been unfortunate enough, or fortunate enough, depending on who you root for. See on stream. Well, that being said, though, all jokes aside, yes, Kondo died and that sucks, but GMU definitely still ahead. Like, that's the kind of thing that if they win this game, they'll look back and laugh.
And if they lose this game, they're like,
if they lose this game, let's not talk about that.
Bad Kondo! Bad Kondo!
Yeah, if that's the highest level of toxicity that these players have, then that'd be a good thing. Oh boy. That was interesting. Still though, UTOS definitely still behind. And the one pick from Primeape onto Kondo is not actually gonna make or break the game here. Kondo is still gonna be pretty strong as his last whisper as well as the double lethality build from the Ghostblade as well as the Knight of Edge combo, and another Drake available. That's going to be a second Mountain Drake, if I'm not mistaken. Yep.
Yep, second Mountain Drake there. It'll especially help during this siege time of the Baron empowered power play. So, Drake, the Mountain Drake heading on over there. Kind of pings going down. One thing that Mason does not have right now is solid vision, solid aggressive vision, other than Trundle. There isn't vision deep into the side of UT's jungle, either or on the top or bottom side, but doesn't look like they need it right now because their four-man siege team is doing work, and Trundle himself can get himself out of trouble on the bottom side.
Yeah, and the reason why this really sucks for UT Austin is because they lose the split pressure battle, the split push from Trundle, empowered with a Baron now, and he still has the teleport available, is going to be pretty tough to deal with. That being said, though, the way the waves were playing out wasn't actually in favor, and he wasn't able to continue pushing, but Deagon, that bottom lane inner turret was dead already. So one inner turret remaining. That Baron buff will expire before they start a siege, but still, this is pretty crazy in terms of the mountain that UT Austin needs to climb now, because they need to kill the Echo, who not... They need to get through two strong tanks with the Spirit Visage, and also, by the way, have now completed the Titanic Hydra. So not only are they tanky as hell, and Trundle has a GA, they're also going to be doing a ton of damage. Like, the amount of DPS one team needs to do versus the other team right now is pretty lopsided, and especially considering the engage is kind of inconsistent from UT Austin, I'm curious to see how they play this out.
Oh, look at Ione, wow. Able to go ahead and get his health back, uses the Subjugate pretty early, and Primeape sitting in the bush. They're just looking for a pick so that they can stop the bleeding of this 4-1. It could be a 1-3-1, but it looks like Mason's going with the 4-1, and any little bit helps right now. Ione is just too big of a monster. Here comes 50 Shades of Kappa. On the Hunt is popped, and there it is. That's how you know when you mess up On the Hunt, when you're a Sivir and you're going back and forth and back and forth. Whoops. Maybe that wasn't the right time to do it.
What can they do? That was their best chance of an engage. But he does have a Guardian Angel. Oh!
Yep, a nice flash pop-up by Firefly, leading into another pop-up, though. So Firefly goes down, GA being popped there by Ione. Does not have Subjugate up, gets the fat flash over the wall. Might be able to live a little bit longer. Gets hit there by the inner flame, and down it goes.
Yeah,
50 Shades of Kappa. Picking
that flash there, probably unnecessary. Actually, certainly shouldn't have used it, but... Really credit to 50 Shades of Kappa, because he was actually zoning Route, Kondo, and Alex. So even though it was a really good flash knockup from Firefly, the DPS, the AD carry, and the mid carry that Echo weren't able to follow up. And as a result, two kills over to UT Austin. So that's the way that they get back in this game. They find those two kills off of a botched teamfight, and now that bottom lane wave has been pushing for so long, this turret is definitely dead.
You can feel the desire from Texas right now, wanting to get themselves back in the game, use that numbers advantage that they have to rotate around, shove in the mid lane, take the blue buff, get some vision down, take the top tower as well, and slow the bleeding down. So a solid play there from University of Texas. And this game, 33 minutes in, 10-9, you can't ask for anything more at 1:39 in the morning. 12:39 if you're in Texas, and whatever time it is over in California, 10:39, 11:39, I don't even know.
Yeah, there's probably anyway. one EU viewer watching the CSL, our diehard fan. It's like 8:30 in the morning, 7:30 in the morning, and he has work.
Yeah, 4:20 a.m. and we're in Los Angeles. It's
solid
stuff right now going on, and both these teams.
It's not 4:20 a.m.
4:20 a.m. Yeah. Whatever, close enough.
What are you talking about? All right, we just got a whisper from our production guy. We're singling you out, production guy. It's not 4:20. Not just yet. At the rate we're going, we might just get there, folks. All right, this seems like a bit of a... We don't really know what to do, so we're all going to just randomly go into this one bush, hope that someone tries to farm Gromp, or excuse me, Krugs, and then kill him, play in this bottom lane. It's worked before, actually, as 50 Shades of Kappa did walk into that lane and get killed by a 2v1. Hopefully, for his sake, it doesn't happen again. Baron up in 20 seconds. Scuttler secured by the red side. And yeah, that's where definitely the next action seems to be heading. See if it actually pans out that way.
All right. Ione does have teleport. Both Route and Ione have teleport. Firefly has Void Rush. I'm surprised they're not splitting a little more. I know they're a little worried about getting hard engaged on by Railgun and Perfect, but you've got Nami to slow down a run up the lane kind of engage, and you've got Kondo who has huge, huge range using piercing arrows. It doesn't look like they want to do that. They're going to go ahead and use the minions, as the minions in the top lane, are shoving in towards University of Texas, and the vision game continues as it has throughout the series. And Mason will strike first, getting vision around the Baron pit, but here comes UT. It's a concerted team effort to clear out the vision around Baron, and that's going to allow Rout some time to shove in the bottom side of the map. It's just a jigsaw puzzle and pieces going back and forth, and there it is. There's the ult, and Kondo gets caught. The bubble, he's able to flash over the wall. 50 Shades of Kappa, oh, misses his ultimate. No one's going to be feeling the verdict this time, but it does allow University of Texas an opportunity to turn to the Elder Drake.
Yeah, that would be a really, really strong objective for this. Actually, not even. They're just going to play for the potential pick. Nope, looks like they're going for it. And that's exactly what they need. That was literally one of the only ways to flash stun the AD carry. But now they don't actually want to make the trade happen. Deagon, they want to stop this Baron, but I don't know if there's enough time. Actually, just kidding. There's no AD carry, no Echo. So teleport will force them away.
Yeah, teleport was forced away, and you know, to be honest, I think 50 Shades of Kappa messed that one up. He could have teleported up to the minions on the top side of the map to lead into a pincer.
That'd be a bit spicy, though.
Wave. Yeah, it would have been a little
spicy. I don't know if they would have made it there in time. They do have Carbon Sivir, though.
Yep, Trundle forced to teleport back to help out. Now Rout's going to try to ignore that damage and take down the tower. He's able to. Now 50 Shades of Kappa in a whole world of hurt right now. He's all by himself. Gonna try to stop Rout.
They can't answer
Not
this.
Gonna be able to.
There's no way.
And Rout is just gonna go ahead and ignore him the best and take that one down. Does have his ult, but now in the mid lane, UT finding the engage onto Mason. Down goes Alex. Did not use Tidal Wave. So on the hunt is still popped. Firefly able to get away. So it's inhibitor for the bottom side of the map for a kill onto the support. Rout very low. Forced to use Chrono Break, goes backwards, and now the mid lane is getting sieged up by UT. This game's been popped wide open. Ione able to get down and use Subjugate onto the correct target, so he's beefy, he's tanky, he's trying to get in there. Now getting popped up by Daisy. Vincent trying to get in there and deal damage. Railgun trying to deal damage to the tower, and it will be a successful siege from Texas. All the while, finally, oh, it's a teleport coming in from Echo. Echo thinking about it, looking at his way in. Firefly's going to join his mid laner. Here comes the heal from Redemption. Rout forced to go a little bit further back. Does have Chrono Break. It's back up again. IO trying to get to the back line. Does go down with the GA pop. Firefly also retreating. Not exactly sure what he's going to do. He's actually just going to fall. It's Railgun on a rampage. 6-2. On the hunt gets popped for the second time while I've been shoutcasting. Alex able to go ahead and get a nice little pop-up. The ultimate coming from Zyndra, not going to be enough, but that's going to be a kill. Vincent picks that one up.
Gone.
Echo's forced to back up, and it's an inhibitor trade after all of that. Mid inhibitor goes down for George Mason for the bottom inhibitor.
Losing mid inhib and also Baron. No, they might not even go for Baron. They're going to the top lane right now. And heading towards the Baron. Yeah, there's no way with two members down that I mean, I guess the Rek'Sai could tunnel over and try to smite steal this, but that's still going to be so risky. That being said, there's a giant inhibitor-less minion wave in the bottom from Red'Sai pushing in, so this Baron could be the game.
This Baron could be the game. Kondo is there, has a lot of damage. Firefly is here as well. Daisy goes down. Rout just gets hooked up on a huge Chrono Break from Rout. Breaks this game wide open. Kondo's able to go ahead and pick one up as well. Rout trying to pick up another kill. He's not able to, but down goes Sivir. So yes, he's able to. Crazy, crazy play. Now delaying these recalls, that might be it. There's not a lot of wave clear on the side of Texas.
Oh my God. Oh my goodness. Rout opened up that bottom lane by split pushing on the Echo, and now it's hit the virus and the Rek'Sai to end the game. Poppy's gonna try and do what he can, but 50 Shades of Kappa just gets deleted by Kondo and the rest of the team. And Deagon, that's gonna be it.
It's gonna be it.
Moving on.
George Mason University on the back of their mid laner route, winning this one with a 1-3-1 composition. Texas almost fought back with a great, great play. I just can't believe the last 5 minutes of League of Legends that
Damn.
I can see.
The entire time talking about the Trundle and the Rek'Sai's split pushing potential. No, Rout says screw that. I'm the Fed Echo. Has a Lich Bane, has so much ability power. And then the catch there, the Baron play by UT. What a risk they took. What a risk they lost. And for them, that's it. They're done. They're out. George Mason University are the Texas Slayers. Two Texas teams down so far, and they're looking for more.
And so just like that, after one hell of a night of League of Legends, is it 2006 again? Is George Mason dancing their way into the Final Four of the South Bracket? It definitely looks like they are the 15th seed. The 15th seed moving on, and they'll play the winner of Texas A&M and UVA, who will be playing earlier. What a display. What a game from Rout. He played to the absolute limits, and you kind of feel bad for Texas because they walked into his ultimate two or three times, and Rout took advantage of it multiple times.
I will say, though, we've said 15th seed, but for all the GMU fans and confused viewers of Twitch chat, GMU lost one game to a forfeit, Deegan. They didn't actually lose a single match so far. So that streak continues. The only thing that has killed them has been their own lack of planning, it seems. And at this point in the game, they've secured themselves that next tier of cash scholarship, I should say. GMU, man. What the hell was that series? Like, actually, because that
was a finals.
That was nuts.
That was the finals. It wasn't perfect by any means.
Jesus Christ. I don't understand how that game lasted for 15 minutes without anything happening. And then the last 25 minutes or whatever are left and right. Wow. All right. That was something. And honestly, like you said, University of Virginia up against Texas A&M, if I'm not mistaken. It's going to be another match to look out for, because that's another Virginia versus Texas clash. The Southern region is full then, man.
Yeah, all the other states kind of not being taken accounted for. The two big ones are leading the way. So with that closes the chapter of an exciting night of League of Legends, of collegiate esports here on the Collegiate Star League. But it also opens the chapter of the rounds of eight here in the ULAW Campus Series. George Mason moving on, and will be playing the winner of Texas A&M and UVA sometime next week in the Final Four. But with that, that's been our night. I don't want to wrap up. I want to keep talking about this. But
all right, I'm not going to lie. For anyone still listening, I'm currently... So yeah, you're laughing because you know the story. There's currently... Like, the place I'm living in rents an Airbnb downstairs. So I really hope the people downstairs haven't been awoken by our 2 a.m. screeching.
No, definitely not. So we'll close it out here. It's been one heck of a night. Be back all this week. It's college esports, and come join it. We're getting to the good teams, getting to the good games. All the teams making great, great decisions, and they'll provide you with a heck of a night of League of Legends. So to close it out one more time, with me was C-Moose. I am Daniel D. Gonzalez. Thank you so much for tuning in. We'll see you next time here on the Collegiate Star League.
Only $14.99.
Yeah, I need to fix my mic.
Don't miss the call. Download Band. Communication made easy.
Ben, Sam, and Ken are on separate journeys to defeat the menacing vile dragon. But let's just say luck isn't on their side. If only there was a way for them to find each other and band together. Well, that's why there's Band. It's a mobile app that allows people to come together using common interests. With Band, you can find fellow gamers, chat, schedule gaming sessions, and conduct polls. Stage epic battles with friends while sharing videos and photos along the way. So try Band today. Band. Be together. We'll be right back.